All righty. Good morning, everybody. Is this on? Good morning, everybody. There you go. Y'all are still full of turkey, evidently, still recovering from the turkey overload, obviously. So if you were here last weekend, you remember Mike talked about we had this quartet that sang and did a wonderful job and said that, yeah, they didn't have a name yet. And then he talked about his own band up here, how long they've been playing together for quite a while, and they don't have a name for their band. So I think I have the perfect name for their band. I think he should name the band Ceiling. Yeah, Ceiling, because see, if he did that, then that would make all of us a bunch of big Ceiling fans. So we could be Ceiling fans. So I don't know. Think about it. It's free. It didn't cost you a dime. We get shirts made. Yeah. Okay. He's not going with it, evidently. All right. Here's what we've got going on the next week or two. Today we have, or not today, but tomorrow night, we have the ladies' event, the Blessings of Christmas. And so, ladies, it's tomorrow night, 6:30, and you can still sign up for helping with decorating tables, bringing food, that type of thing. And one thing that hasn't been talked about a lot is that there is a gift exchange. And so the gifts are $15 to $20, and you bring them wrapped, and you don't have a name on them or anything. But you don't have to do it, okay? It's optional to do that. So I'm just reminding you ladies that that is something that takes place at the event. And also, if you can help, if anybody can help, we're going to break down the chairs in here after the service, and we're going to bring tables in, all the tables, and we're going to set up, if we don't mind, as soon as the service is over, if anybody can stay a little bit longer and help, we're going to be setting this up into a nice big banquet hall, basically, for tomorrow night, okay? Then also, don't forget, we have prayer for our country, for our church, that is at 4:30 this evening. We have a CPR class, that's next Saturday. That will be next Saturday. That's all-day event. There's a sign-up out there, so if you're interested, we already got 8 or 10 people signed up for that. Christmas food baskets. We give away tons of food, household items. You won't believe all the stuff that gets given away. Boxes and boxes go out of here. If you'd like to help support that, just on your check or on your envelope, just write Christmas food baskets. Make sure that the money goes directly to that. We have our disability support ministry. That's a new ministry that's starting to kick off, gain some momentum. If you want to be a part of a training meeting, that will be next Sunday night at 6:30. Our big Christmas dinner. We do this every year. It's a wonderful event. It is going to be on Sunday, December the 15th, and we're going to provide all the meats and stuff. But if you'll do the sides and the desserts, things like that, there are some sign-ups out there for you to help with that. You can sign up and just bring whatever you would like to bring. Chocolate would be best. Sides, desserts, potatoes, all that stuff's out there. There's a couple of baby showers. There's information in your bulletin about that next Sunday. And then choir, if you're part of the choir, they're meeting today at 5:30, right? 5:30. All righty. Well, I know we've had a busy weekend, lots going on, but don't you love that now we can come and we get to worship and rest and seek the face of Jesus. And so we're going to pray right now as we begin. Father God, thank you so much. Thank you so much for Jesus. Thank you for salvation. God, we've experienced a lot of good things this weekend. It's all been good. But the best is Jesus. The best is being able to come right here and worship and adore you and just speak to us today, dear Jesus. Speak to our hearts, God. May we hear from you the words that you have. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
All right, let's stand. Here we go.
Praise be a weapon that conquers all anxiety. Let it rise. Let praise arise. We sing your name in the dark and it changes everything. We sing with all we are and we claim your victory. Let it rise, let praise arise. We'll see you break down every wall. We'll watch the giants fall. For fear cannot survive when we praise you. The God of breakthroughs on our side. Forever lift him high. With all creation cry, God, we praise you. Oh, we praise you. Oh, let faith be the song. Freedom feels like this is what heaven sounds like. We praise you, we praise you. Come on, this is what living looks like. This is what freedom feels like. This is what heaven sounds like. We praise you, we praise you. This is what living looks like. This is what freedom feels like. This is what heaven sounds like. We praise you, we praise you.
It's good to see you. Are you glad to be back? All right. Anybody have any leftover turkey? I do. And I don't like turkey. And I don't like leftovers. So if you need some, I have some. Just give Carol a call. She'll bring it to you. No, sir. Thank you, BC.
I think it's so wonderful that our church and our fellowship always prays for our military. I know I don't need to remind you of this, but without these young people, so maybe some of them aren't young, but without these men and women that are on the screen, plus all of their comrades around the world, plus those of us that are here today that have served, without them, do you stop and think all the time about how bad your life would be here in the United States? Nod your head if you understand that. Without these guys protecting the interests that we have. And now it's Christmas time. They're away from home, possibly. Many of them are, and that's a tough time, a tough time, especially if you're in the military. I remember the only time that I ever was away from home in my entire life at Christmas was when my unit, 1152 Echo Company Air Wing, 1st Marine Division, was assigned to duty. We were not home. missed Christmas at home. And it was a lonely time. And I want us, as we think about these guys on the wall, to think about doing something like this story I want to share with you before I pray, doing something that would make them feel at home, make them feel that Christmas was there for them. There were three young men in our company that were from Oklahoma City. I didn't know them until I got to the Marine Corps. But we were talking and we said, you know, it's Christmas Eve, what are we gonna do? We decided to go down to the Geedunk and get some pogey bait. How many of you know what a Geedunk is and what pogey bait is? Okay, I got a couple of Marines here. Geedunk means a snack bar, and pogey bait means crisp candy, cake, ice cream, all that stuff. And we were sitting there, and I was talking to those three boys. We were talking about how lonely we were and about how Christmas memories were flooding that little table we were sitting there. And I asked one of the young men, I said, what's your Christmas memory? And he said, Tate, you know the thing that I miss right now the most was growing up as a kid in Oklahoma City, all four of us growing up in Oklahoma City. One of my favorite memories was Mom coming in, and she was always singing Christmas carols. I'm going to miss that this year. She was always laughing. It's just Christmas for her. But my favorite memory, he said, was when she would come in and she would say, hey, guys, maybe it was on TV, on the radio, but her favorite Christmas song. And she would come and yell, Dad, come on, guys. And for her, when that song came on, it was Christmas. And she said, I'm going to miss so much hearing my mom's excitement when she hears that song and says, oh, come on, everybody sing, everybody sing. And he said, we would stand there and sing and throw our heads back. And we knew it was Christmas when we all began to sing, jewelry is the gift to give, so it's the gift that'll live and live. So give the gift you know can't fail from B.C. Clark's anniversary sale. Most sales are after Christmas, but Clark's is just before. So everything is marked way down, savings you can't ignore. At Oklahoma's oldest jewelers since 1892. So give the gift you know can't fail from B.C. Clark's anniversary sale. Yeah, and by the time he started, all of us that grew up in Oklahoma City knew that, and we were just singing it at the top of our lungs, and everybody else, all those other Marines sitting in there, looked at us like we were idiots, which we were. But you know, in that one little moment, Dwayne, we felt at home. We felt home. So let's all try to do something for these that, if you know any of them, that will make them feel like they're home. They're home. Let's pray. Father, thank you for these on the screen. And of these that are not going to be together with family at Christmas, Father, bring through someone here in this congregation the ability to contact them, write them, maybe call them, send a gift that will make them feel at home, like we felt that night, Christmas Eve, sitting in that Geedunk, singing at the top of our lungs, something that made us feel like we were at home. And I pray it in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you.
I stand amazed in the presence of Jesus the Nazarene, and wonder how he could love me, a sinner condemned unclean, singing how marvelous, how wonderful, and my song shall ever be. How marvelous, how wonderful is my Savior's love for me. He took my sin and my sorrow. His face I at last shall see. 'Twill be my joy through the ages to sing of his love for me. Singing how marvelous, how wonderful, and my song shall ever be. How marvelous, how wonderful is my Savior's love for me. Singing how marvelous, how wonderful, and my song shall singing how marvelous, how wonderful, and my song shall ever be. How marvelous, how wonderful is my Savior's love for me.
God, we thank you for that marvelous love. Thank you, God, that in this day, Lord, that in the spirit of thankfulness and gratefulness, God, that you give us so much to be thankful for. But I pray for that person, God, that's struggling, that person that's struggling with illness or a family member in a hospital or the death of a loved one. Or God, maybe they're experiencing joy today. Whatever it is, we just thank you that you walk with us through those moments. God, teach us to be a holy, living sacrifice. It's in your name that I pray. Amen.
morning. I said this during the first service, and I still mean it now. I love this. I love doing this. I love being up here. I hope Bruce is having a good time with his family, because I'm having a good time right now. But we are going to be in the book of Romans, chapter 12, verses 1 and 2. Feel free to go ahead and start turning there. And while you're turning, I have a question I'd like to see with a show of hands. How many of you would say, I'm a feeler? And what that means is I feel my emotions very deeply. I connect with people very easily. Like, that's the kind of person that I am. Awesome. Seeing some of the faces, I agree. You guys are wonderful. You guys have such big hearts. You connect with people. I envy that so much. How many of you would say that you are an analytical person? I take things, I pick it apart, I get to the center of the truth, and that's what it is. Anybody like that? Yeah, that's me, for sure. I do that too. And as a very analytical person, when I look at things, I want to see what the truth is. And therefore, there's this little thing in grammar called an oxymoron. Drives me crazy. It drives me absolutely crazy. It's like when somebody says, oh, same difference. Nuh-uh. No, because it's different. It's not the same. That's why it's different. It's like somebody says, potato, potato. Uh-uh, potato, potato. There's a reason why you're saying it different, and I want to know. I don't know why. Maybe I'm just a little weird or a lot of weird. I don't know. It very well could be both. But there's this, in this scripture that we look at, Paul has an interesting oxymoron. And since it's from God's word, I'm not going to let this one bother me. Let's read it together, verses 1 and 2, chapter 12. It says, therefore, brothers and sisters, in view of the mercies of God, I urge you to present your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and pleasing to God. This is your true worship. Do not be conformed to this age, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind, so that you may discern what is the good, pleasing, and perfect will of God. So it starts off here, it says, therefore, brothers and sisters, in view of the mercies of God. It's the very start. And there's a command here, it's like, I urge. It's a call to action. It's saying, I want you to accomplish the thing I'm about to say to you. But before that, it says, therefore, brothers and sisters. The first point I want you guys to see, only a believer can follow this command that he's about to give. Only a believer can follow this command. Because he's speaking, brothers and sisters, he's speaking to fellow Christians at the church in Rome. It's brothers and sisters, and it also says, in view of the mercies of God. We're saying only someone who has experienced and knows and understands the incredible mercies of God is going to be able to do what I'm about to command you. That's what Paul is saying. And realize we're at the tail end of the book of Romans. Chapters 1 all the way through 11 is like the greatest explanation and theology of the gospel ever. It's incredible. It explains so clearly like where we were. We were in sin. We were separated from God. And then God, through Christ Jesus, came to this world and died the death that we deserved. He made a way for us to be with God. We're no longer slaves to sin. Instead, we're slaves to righteousness. We're not tied to sin. We're tied to God. It's in 11 chapters of awesome, and you guys should definitely read it because I read it too often. I don't know if that's too often. I don't think there's a too often. But when we get to Romans chapter 12, it's taking all of what he's already said, all these mercies, this incredible gospel of Jesus, and he says, and this is what you do about it. I urge you, after seeing the mercies, after reading all that I've written to you already, he says, I urge you to present your bodies as a living sacrifice. Now, the living sacrifice, that's the oxymoron. And he, remember, when we look at scripture, we need to look at it through the eyes of the people who would have read it first or heard it first. And these are Jews and Greek, Roman Gentiles. Both of their histories when it comes to religious practices was sacrifice. The Jews would sacrifice animals as atonement for their sins. In the same way, the Greeks and the Romans had animal sacrifices in these like pagan rituals. And so both of them would understand very clearly that if something is a sacrifice, the whole point is that it dies. Like the thing that is sacrificed dies. And so when Paul says, present yourself as a living sacrifice, they would say, well, Paul, that's dumb. A little bit, because that's not what that means. How can, if something is going to be living, it has to live. For something to be a sacrifice, it has to die. And so, the next point is the command seems dumb, but it is holy, acceptable, and true worship. Now, I promise I'm not calling God's word dumb. I promise that's not happening. But when the Jews and the Gentiles looked at this and they heard this word from Paul, their first thought was, what does that mean? How can something be both living and a sacrifice? And I think Paul explains that. But before we dive into that, he says that being a living sacrifice is three things. It's holy, acceptable or pleasing, and it's true worship. Now, a lot of times when we look at something that's holy, what we think of that is that it's morally good, something that is like perfect and right. And but what holy really means is that it's set apart. I have a room in my house. It's an office. I use it. I pray in there. I read my scripture in there. I write sermons in there. I specifically use that room for this purpose. It's set apart. It's different than the rest of my house, and it's dedicated to God and His word. That room in my home is holy. In the same way, like the Israelites, they were chosen by God. They were set apart as something different than the rest of the world. They were dedicated specifically to God, and when that happened, they were considered holy. And so if we live as a living sacrifice, what that means is we are set apart, different than the rest of the world, dedicated to God, holy. And then it also says that it's pleasing to God. Now, pleasing to God I've heard it explained like this. It's very simple. God likes it. Acceptable to God, pleasing to God, that's something that is in line with God's will, and He likes and accepts things that are in line with Him. So being a living sacrifice, God wants that. He likes that. It's acceptable and pleasing to Him. And then it also says that it's true worship. Now, some of your Bible translations, yours may say reasonable service. And that's because that's what the words mean. Then straight from Greek, it's reasonable service. The reasonable part of it, it's saying that it's like a correct or true thing. It's the correct response. A true response. That's why some say true worship. And then that word for service, it's what it means is acts of devotion to God. That's why they usually translate it as worship, because it's service to God, but it's service specifically as acts of devotion to Him. And so they call it true worship because it's the correct acts of devotion to God. And I feel like when we picture what worship is, most of us, our mind goes directly to what we were doing just a few moments ago. We come into this church on Sunday morning, we stand up, we are led by incredible people, and then we praise, we sing. But the problem is, because that's what's in our minds, we leave those sets of doors right there and the worship stops. That is not true worship. That is one act of worship that is supposed to continue. Being a living sacrifice, the thing we're about to get into, it means we die to ourselves and become a sacrifice so that we may live for the Lord. And that means that our entire life needs to reflect and praise and adore God. That's what worship is praising and adoring God. And so our entire life is worship. The way that you serve your family and your church is worship to God. The way that you act towards other people, whether it be in love and gentleness or the opposite of those two, will reflect how you are worshiping God with your life. The decisions that you make will reflect what you're worshiping, because everybody worships something. What you live for will show the rest of the world what you worship. If you live for God consistently with your life, giving acts of devotion to Him, that will show what you worship. And if you are not living for Him and you're living for other things, you'll be worshiping them instead. This command, it didn't make sense. Some would call it ridiculous. I did technically call it dumb. But it is holy. It's set apart for God. It's pleasing. God likes it. And it's true worship in all of the ways that we live. And in the next verse, verse 2, Paul begins to point out, he explains what being a living sacrifice looks like. If we read it again, verse 2, it says, "Do not be conformed to this age, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind." It's very simple. It's do not be conformed, instead be transformed. Being conformed means I'm being molded into the image of something. The more time I spend with my friends, the more I look like them. That's just the truth. I act like them. I become like them. I start to look more and more like they do. When we're conformed to something, we become the image of that thing. And it says, do not be conformed to this age, this world around us, the age that we live in, which we are supposed to be separate from. If we are holy, we're set apart. We're different than the world around us. That's how people see us as Christians. But sometimes when we walk outside of those doors, we become completely, I guess the word is imperceptible as Christians. Shoot, that happened to me a lot when I was in high school. I went to youth group on Wednesdays. I acted like this incredibly good kid. I was like, hey, I know scripture. I love scripture. Praise be to God. All of that. And then as soon as I walked out those doors, it was like, oh, finally. And I just took off the coat that I had been masking my real self under. I was conformed because I looked like the rest of the world. And if you had asked anybody during that time in my life, if I was a Christian, by the way that I act, they would have said, there's no way. We cannot just be conformed to the world. And the next point in your notes, we have two options. You must either die to the world or let the world control you. If you're going to be a living sacrifice, you must either die to the world or let the world control you. And there's no third option. You will either live for the Lord with your life or you will not. The thing that you worship will control you. Earlier in Romans, it speaks a lot of being a slave to sin and being a slave to righteousness. Saying when we encounter Jesus, when we believe in Him, when He changes us, we are no longer slaves to this sin, to this world. We are now slaves to righteousness. A slave has no will of their own. That was the purpose. They lived specifically for the will of the master, of the Lord. In the same way, the Bible uses that language for us. Paul himself says, I am a slave, a bond servant of Christ Jesus. And what he's saying when he says that is, I do not live for myself. I live only for the will of my Lord. That's why we say we confess Jesus as Lord of our life. And so when we call ourselves Christians, we have an option. We have to die to ourself. That's how we become a sacrifice. We put down the things in our life that are not from Christ, and we put them aside, and we become a living sacrifice because we're connected to the only real source of life. And if you don't die to the world, you will belong to it. It will control you. Because we all worship something. If it's not God, it's the world. Something in it. Do not be conformed. Do not look like the world. Do not chase the things that the world wants. The world wants wealth, power, material things. They chase things that aren't from God. They chase selfish desires by any means necessary to gain what you want. That's what our culture tells us. You need to be independent. You need to do what's best for you. Live your best life. Don't live for anybody else. We need to live for the Lord. Instead of being conformed, we're supposed to be transformed. Transformed is the word we get metamorphosis from. That's what it is in the Greek. I have trouble pronouncing it. I don't know why. I've taken so many Greek courses. But it's metamorphosthe. Metamorphosthe is the word that's in here. And so it's an idea of being completely transformed. You were one thing and now you are another. It's the butterfly where it's a caterpillar, they go into the chrysalis and they come out as something that is new and changed and different. That's what it means to be transformed. And so when we are transformed, it says, and be transformed by the renewing of your mind. That word renewing, it's like a change of heart. It's this idea of we experience something and it completely changes our outlook on life. A lot of us, when we accept Christ for the first time, it's because we encountered Jesus and he changed the way that we see the world. I mean, we're getting close to Christmas. There's a perfect example in Ebenezer Scrooge. I mean, he's this cold-hearted man. And then he experiences through the ghost of past, present, and future. He sees things in a new way. He experiences it and he becomes a generous and joyful man because his experience changed his heart. That's what it looks like when we are transformed by the renewing of our mind. Our heart, our outlook is transformed by the mercies of God. Because we've experienced Jesus. We've known Jesus. We see his love, his grace, his mercy. We see his incredible act of redemption and salvation. And we say, you are Lord. And the rest of my life is going to be focused on that truth. That's what it means to be transformed. And then after that, it says, be transformed by the renewing of your mind. And then it gives us a purpose, the reason why. It says, so that you may discern what is the good, pleasing, and perfect will of God. Some of your translations may say something different, just a little bit. And I'm going to disagree with this one just a little bit. Because there's a word in there that means to prove something. It means to prove because you have tested the value and the worth of something, and therefore you have proved it to be valuable and good. So when you test something, I call it the CAMS explanation translation, and that's when I just try to make scripture a little easier for my brain to understand. Instead of saying like, so that you may discern or so that by testing, I say you may prove what the will of God is. That's the easiest way that I've understand it, the way that it's been taught to me as well. It's so that you may prove what the will of God is, what is good and acceptable and perfect. And therefore, what I want you guys to see, it says, when we are transformed, we are living proof. We're living proof that God's way works. When we are transformed by the renewing of our mind, we are proof that God's will is good, that it's pleasing, that it's perfect. We are the example. When we go out into this world and people see the way that we live, we should be the proof that God's way is the best way, that it works. We live in a culture that wants nothing to do with the way we live. Nothing. I can't tell you how many people I have shared the gospel with, and they'll say, you know, I like what you're saying, and I might think about that when I'm old and frail, but right now I just kind of want to, I want to live the way I want to live for now. And what that is an act of selfishness, saying, I don't want anything to do with God. Instead, I'm going to worship and follow myself. If you look at marriage and you look at the statistics behind it, when people are following God's way of marriage, when they follow what is in this word and what it says about marriage, the chances of successful marriages skyrockets. When they are following God's word and what it says, when men are sacrificing for their wives in the way that Christ sacrificed himself for his bride, the church. When that happens, the success of marriage skyrockets. And when people start to deviate from that, the failure rate skyrockets. And what that shows to me is that God's way of marriage works. It's better. Otherwise, they'd fail. And in the same way, when we are transformed, when we are not conformed to this age, but when we look different than it does, we are proof to the whole world that God's way is better, that God's way works, that there is life and hope and joy and peace. And so if we are going to be transformed, if we are going to show the world that his way works, that God's way works, something has to die and something has to live. Dying to yourself means that you are giving up your wills, your wants, and your desires. Dying to yourself means I'm putting myself, what I want, who I used to be before Jesus, I'm putting it in the ground and I'm leaving it behind. It's no part of yourself that you drag along. You buy in completely. I have a lot of friends who are in ministry. And something that they talked about a lot while they were in seminary is, okay, I got to have something to fall back on. It's like, I need to study something else so that if ministry doesn't work out, I can just fall back on that and I'll be okay. And my very thought of that is, dude, you're going into ministry for the wrong reason. If you need something to fall back on when God has called you to serve him with all that you are in this incredible, like, you are serving his people, you are serving the Lord, you don't need anything to fall back on. If you have to fall back on it, that's because you screwed up, not because God screwed up. In the same way, we're not dragging a piece of ourself with us that we want to fall back on. We bury it. It's dead. It's gone. It is sacrificed on the altar of our life so that we might live for him and for him alone. That's the proof of how God's way works. So I'm going to ask the band to come back up. And my question to you today is, have you been transformed? Have you died to yourself? If I was summarizing this scripture, I'd say, I die to myself and live for Christ to prove God's way works. That's the simplest part. I die to myself and live for Christ to prove God's way works. And so my question is, are you so totally bought in to the mercies of God that you are willing to get out of your own way? Have you been so transformed by God and His mercy and His salvation that you're willing to bury your wills, your wants, and your desires to follow Him completely? What is in your life right now that needs to go? What is in the way of your faith that you need to bury, that needs to die so that you can live for Him? The answer for all of you is going to be different, but the response is the same. Bring it to Jesus. If you need to accept Jesus for the first time, if you've never known Him, if you've never accepted Him as Lord, you can do that today. Come see that God's way works. And if you have, and you have something in your life that you know is impeding your relationship with God, impeding how the world sees you as His follower, deal with that today. Come pray. Give it up to God. Ask Him to break that in your life, and then do everything that you can to follow Him. Let's pray. Lord, I love You and I praise You. God, thank You for Your Son, Jesus Christ. Thank You, Lord, that we are different from this world. Lord, we're not conformed to the image of this world. We're conformed to the image of Jesus. Lord, give everyone in this room, give each of us the courage, Lord, the knowledge of how we can die to ourselves and follow You. Lord, help us to turn away from those things and to chase You with all that we are. We love You, Lord. It's in the name of Jesus I pray. Amen.
Here's my heart, Lord. Here's my heart, Lord. Here's my heart, Lord. Speak what is true. Here's my heart, Lord. Here's my heart, Lord. Here's my heart, Lord. Speak what is true, 'cause I am found, I am Yours, I am loved, I'm made pure, I have life, I can breathe, I am healed, I am free. Here's my heart, Lord. Here's my heart, Lord. Here's my heart. Speak what is true, 'cause I am found, I am Yours, I am loved, I'm made pure, I have life, I can breathe, I am healed,
speak what is true.